Thank you very much, David, and good to see you. It's lovely to be back here again. The very first time I came to Finland was I was a consultant to a company in Pori called Outokumpu. Is that how you pronounce it, Kimmo? Oh, I'm doing better. And I was asked to come over here for a day. It's quite a long drive, isn't it? To give a seminar at the university here. And when I was giving my seminar, my host from Outokumpu was drinking vodka. And when we got back to Poro, he had lost the key to the guest house, and there was 2 feet of snow. And so I remember vividly coming here, because we spent an hour trying to get into this guest house when we were absolutely frozen. But it's good to come back here and to see what CSC are doing, because I think they're a really fantastic example of what we should be doing in other parts of Europe. And certainly, Kimmo, to spare your blushes, I said to my own GIST committee in the UK, why don't we just get CSE to do it for us? But they probably won't. Okay, well, as you probably know, I wear a number of hats, and in the past I was chairman of ESFRI, and I'm now chairman of the European Research Area Board, which is meant to be at least the top-level research board for the Commission. And so I report directly to Mrs. Geoghegan-Quinn, and Nelly Kroes and a few others on where we should be going. On the other hand, I would say we are independent. We're meant to be giving free advice. Whether they take notice of it is another matter. So this is my advice. It won't necessarily be what the Commission will do, and Carlos may be able to tell you that later on. Okay, well, I always start with this in that about 2 years ago, my son asked me what it was like to do a PhD, and I started telling him, and then I realized that what I was telling him is what I did 40 years ago, and things have changed. And it's up to the research community to own the future and take charge of it, not let it happen to them. And why is that? Because research is really going global, or has gone global, if you like, and in this context, we have to think about what role Europe has to play in the big global environment as China and India and Brazil become much more dominant than they have in the past. On the other hand, Europe is the largest economy in the world, and we ought to take leadership on it. Also, whether the snow here has anything to do with the global warming or global cooling, I don't know. I had an idea that there are more and more obese people in Europe at the moment than ever before, that we should put them all on one side of the North Pole and move the axis of the Earth so that we change the global environment. That's a simple solution, hardly likely to be accepted. But there are more and more grand challenges in front of us in terms of the weather, in terms of energy, in terms of health, and so on. And we can't just go on as we are, and we need to work together. So how do we do that? And what is the role, then, of the individual researcher in this environment? It's quite a difficult one to think about. And you can't just ignore it. The world of research is changing. There's still a need for the dedicated person sitting in the laboratory at the desk or wherever, but more and more we need to integrate this. The problems are so immense that we need to try and bring this group together in some way. And I asked the question, has the PhD gone past its sell-by date? I don't think it has, but you have to realize it's less than 100 years old in the UK. It's a very new invention, and we actually need to reinvent it to train people more effectively for this environment. Then the other thing, too, which is coming clear, is that we're more and more dependent on large research infrastructures, whether they're physical or dispersed, both of them are there. And how to manage those is extremely important. And my experience going around Europe is that there's very little management experience, in fact, almost none in some countries, of what we mean by a large international research infrastructure. And therefore, the role of e-science becomes more and more important as we go forward. Well, this is just a bit of the same thing, really. Within this context, where does the student sit, and how do we train them? How do we develop the academics to train people to fit into this environment? It's something we really haven't started. And where is creativity in this context? Are we starting to become more machine-like rather than creative people? I don't think so, but we need to be aware of that. The other thing, too, is that Most of the challenges before us need many techniques, many environments, many disciplines to solve. And users are not necessarily, in fact, almost entirely not experts in the machines, in the research infrastructures that we're using. This is especially true at the moment in biology, but it's coming true in all areas of science. You have to rely on other people who you have to trust, and you have to trust with their data that they produce, and you don't have any easy means of checking it. And so this is going to be an interesting area. And biologists at the moment send their protein crystals to Grenoble. They send them by courier, and they come back, and the data all comes down online. They're trusting the BEAM scientists to do the work and the analysis for them. Once we move to other areas where we have less checks, it's going to become more important that we can validate what comes forward. The other thing, too, is about the interoperability between these pieces of equipment. As Kimmo has shown, his paper mill, where was it in? Oh, but we could go slightly further north, couldn't we? Wherever it is in the north, where it's cold and there's a lot of power, your computer or data store will be chugging away. Meanwhile, the experiment will be in Hamburg or Rome or something like that, and they will be interacting with each other in real time. Meanwhile, you will be stuck in Warsaw or Dublin or somewhere. So you're very much further away from the hands-on. I was an electron microscopist when I started, and I actually twiddle the actual knobs that move the beam. No way. You're way away from it. So it's 2, 3, 4 arms length away from the actual experiment. How do you actually organize this? And in the end, as far as data is concerned, you're going to plonk it all in the cloud and hope for the best. Who do you trust? I leave it there because there are people from commercial companies here, but do you want to put it into commercial hands, or do you want to hold on to it? Well, Keith Jeffries from here and David was from here. The two of us are X, aren't we? Well, you still got an office, semi-X. Well, I still have my car to get in. But this was what it is like at the moment in terms of research infrastructure. You can see the synchrotron in the background. The thing with the blue carbuncle on is a neutron source. And in the middle, there's lasers and lots of other stuff and space science and so on. And when I was there, about 7,000 scientists a year would come. Now they can. Now they're beginning more and more to interface with this facility remotely, and luckily, because the road at the we can't see the main road actually, it's further back, is on Friday night almost entirely blocked because there's so much traffic. So wouldn't it be wonderful not to actually have to go? Actually, no, it's a lovely place to work, but we're moving away from that. And this is one of Keith Jeffries' slides, the one on the right. I joke a little bit because my son's working on surface chemistry, and he can do his neutron diffraction work in Oak Ridge at the SNS there at the laboratories there. He can do his X-ray diffraction in Grenoble at the ESRF, and he can do his NMR, the nuclear magnetic resonance studies, in Tokyo. And I joke, but it could be true, that he doesn't have to leave his bedroom to do this work, and he can just get on with it. In fact, the reality is true because at Imperial, where I'm still linked with, we have a direct dark fiber link to Oak Ridge to do the neutron diffraction work, and we can do it in real time where we are without going across the Atlantic. So this is becoming a reality more and more. And so the research infrastructures are central to the way we're doing research, whether we see them or we don't see them, whether they're dispersed or whether they're physical, they're there. And part of this is what e-science is doing for us, and it really is central. This was a slide we had in our report, the S3 roadmap, the first one, but I do believe it's becoming more and more true as we go forward. And we've got a number of dispersed infrastructures already. Here's some that the Commission are supporting. This one is for environmental measurement of atmospheric properties, bringing together a number of laboratories around Europe. You can see the stars. And bring a number of projects with different levels of funding together to work together. So we've got a couple of these, the synchrotron sources as well. They're working together, and I was delighted to hear. Well, it didn't happen. That red star is actually Electra in Trieste, and it was due last week, I think, or the week before, to open its new free electron laser, Fermi. Unfortunately, Monsieur. Or Signor though Sony was not available. he had a young lady to look after, I guess, but well, anyway. But it's going to happen soon. And so we're starting to see these X-ray sources, high-powered X-ray sources, starting to work together and network together. Well, many of you will know, it seems only yesterday, but it was 4 years ago now, that we produced the first S3 roadmap. It's been updated with 44 projects on now, right across from social sciences, arts and humanities, biological, medical, physical and engineering sciences. Preparatory phase funding is out there, funding a lot of projects, and well, this is an old slide. It says about 10 will fly by 2010. In fact, a number are underway. And I chaired the International Steering Committee for the X-ray Free Electron Laser, which I'll talk about a little later. And that started tunneling last year. And just looking recently, it's about 20% the tunnel for the X-ray Free Electron Laser is completed. So quite a lot of these projects are underway. Some of them, I don't know why they're not underway, because they don't need too much effort to get going. But certainly in the medical area, things are much slower than they are in the in our area, in the physical sciences area. Here are some of the projects. These are the ones within the social sciences and humanities area. I'll just look at each one of them a bit in turn for you. This is CESESDA. This is a social science data archives in 20 countries. And I think the key thing is they're increasing the quality of available data so people know what they're talking about in this area. Here's some facts about it. It's 20 countries. It's been going for some time, but now it's actually become much more formalized, and you can see there how many data sets they have in terms of growing, and that was in 2007, and it's growing much more since then. And it's a legal entity, and one of the things that the EC has done has to create the ERICS, the European Research Infrastructure Consortia Agreements, and that helps a lot of these projects move forward. So one of the things you learn very quickly in research infrastructure is that you have to become a lawyer fairly quickly in order to bring all these parties together. I call it Daria, but they call it Daria, I think. Isn't that right? Daria was a king way back in Egyptian... No, no, Keith, help me out. Persian times. times. Whatever way you call it, this is preservation of heritage materials. Again, we tend to forget about this, but there's a whole load of stuff in museums and elsewhere that needs to be archived and shared, so you don't have to go to these places and see them. You can actually analyze them remotely. So that's that one. The social survey, this has been going for some time, but more and more countries are joining in, bringing together longitudinal studies on social trends. And this is extremely important for policymakers to know what's going on in terms of society. And again, the thing there, data is publicly available as soon as possible, 30 countries in that. And you can see that the costs really aren't that great, actually, to get these going. This is a little bit more about the partnership, and I think it's growing year by year. So I'll move on. This is one of the so in-between ones, which is either social sciences or medical, whichever way you look at it. It's a survey of health, aging, and retirement share. This is underway now, and it's linked with the US and the NIH studies. And again, it's longitudinal study of aging. I think I was just talking to Carlos. He had his birthday yesterday. He takes 1 year away. He didn't say from what number each year, but some of us are getting older. I'm going the other way. And it's obviously of very much interest because... aging and health are becoming more dominant as we get older. Then there's more and more demands on the social systems, and governments want to know how to react to that. The one I like, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about, well, I like them all, obviously, but this is one that's a favorite of mine, is Clarin, which is a common language resources, and it's a semantic web-based language repository saying what do words mean in context, historical context, and in the social context, and then even in the sentence. And you'll see a little later on what sort of things they do, but I want to take it further than that. So here we are. It's a Federation of Digital Archives, Language Data. Peter Wittenberg, who was on the high-level group with me looking at data, was the guy who sort of runs the infrastructure, and Stephen Clower at Utrecht University is the sort of leader on it, extremely interesting to talk to. But do you see, they say their target audience is humanities and social science scholars. Actually, it's far more than that. because governments are interested in this, because if you know what a word means in context, you can start to see that the way forward for intergovernmental agreements and legal agreements becomes much easier. And I've actually soldiered on that basis with Steve and Peter's agreement. Meanwhile, they want to do this sort of work, which probably wouldn't justify the amount of money going in, but the fact that governments are interested does justify it. I don't know how many times you want to find out what Mr. Barroso says in Polish, summarize all the articles in Le Figaro of August 2009 in Polish. I don't know who would want to do that, but I wouldn't know what he wanted to do in English, but let alone Polish. But you can see the sort of thing that's going on here. There's a tool where you can interrogate and say, what does this word mean? What does this phrase mean? What was the context in which it was said? Extremely exciting. But there are a lot of challenges they found out. First of all, they've got a lot of archives there. None of them really sort of talk to each other, and so they've got to interconnect them. They've got to find the tools will also work across the archives, and they have a need for common standards. Certain languages are covered more than others, I shouldn't belittle Finnish, but it is one of the more difficult languages in Europe, trying to make sure that the systems cover every one of the languages. And there's need for consultation. What's the main challenges? Getting academics and others to take it up. There's an environment there where the academics are used to just sitting in their library and getting on with the work. They've got to be trained in order to take part in this sort of environment. They have no idea what the technology is behind it, and they have no tradition of using and working this way. Having said that, in the UK at least, I found that when I've had meetings with this group of academics, they've been very exciting to work with, because once they've woken up to the fact that these applications are there, they become extremely interested and lots of things are going on. So I have very high hopes. Special challenges, well, since they've had no exposure to this technology, they don't quite know what they need, and they need to know what the potential is. Well, I've already talked about legal challenges. Everybody seems to bring these up before you start. And I think we do need in Europe to look at how we deal with data from a legal point of view. So there's national IPR legislation and all the rest. And one of the things you'll see later on, a recommendation for AIRAB, is to have a common patent and copyright system. Well, there you see the special problems. I think the one at the bottom is probably the most difficult one, the ethical one, where there are different ethical bases, as it were, foundations in different countries about what is private and what isn't private, what comes under freedom of information and what comes under data protection. It's a very difficult line to draw. Well, I said that we produced our roadmap in 2006. It was updated last year. For me, it's a sadness they're still updating it, because what I'd like to see is some of these projects come to realization more than spending your time looking at it. But they're especially important to Finland, and the lady looking after it, Eva Jokinen, was from the Finnish Academy. The Finnish delegation pushed the environmental sciences probably more than anybody else, but they are extremely important. You can see a number of projects here. The boat there is called Aurora Borealis. It's meant, if it gets built, will be the biggest Arctic research ship in the world. But the one I like to talk about is LifeWatch, which is run by Volta Loss out of the University of Amsterdam. Volta again was part of the high-level working group on data, but it does show very easily what we're talking about. Biodiversity is a good measure of what's happening to the climate, and it needs not only to be analysed, but then to give advice on what needs to be done. So it's a scientific and a political challenge. And the system is extremely complicated. In that you can't just do one little bit of work and say that's it. You've got to integrate all these studies together. And you need to look at the whole system to analyse what's going on. So if a plant appears in some desert somewhere, and you have to link that with what's going on in the oceans and what's going on in the clouds and so on. You can't just look at one individual element. And so LifeWatch is an attempt to bring all this lot together. And there's all sorts of things going on, data centers, marine sites, people flying around the world, space observation and so on. as well as the plate tectonics. And then you've got individual sort of bug collections. You've got people working on structural biology, and you've got people looking at systems biology as well. So you've got all these people all working together. And I would say that naturally, they're not, most of them are not people well trained in e-science. So what happens here is that the information comes in, it's brought together into the infrastructure, and the user's quite a long way away. But who's running it all? Well, the data and the analysis is collected at CERN. And I think this is an interesting development that in this area, you should use the people who are experts. So the environmental biologists, whilst knowing what they want and what they want to do, go to the experts who will actually do this for them. And I think more and more we're going to see groups of experts who can actually help others in totally different disciplines come together. We don't all have to be able to operate everything. And this is where the sort of work that CSE does becomes important. And so you bring it all together, and at the end, the users, wherever they are in the world, can access this and do their modeling and all the rest of it. So I think a very interesting structure. In the middle of it all, too, there's some management from the European Space Agency. So what I like about this project, it not only brings together different disciplines, it uses experts wherever they are to make it happen. Okay. And then the other thing, too, is they work with other European projects like Elixir, which is an infrastructure for biological information, which is probably going to be the biggest demand on data resources of all the projects, even more than CERN and the others. I don't know if it's true, but they say that if Moore's Law continues, they will run out of data storage space in 2020. Where, however you look at it, they're going to be big. The project I've worked on most is this one, the X-ray free electron laser in Hamburg. This is the picture of what it will look like eventually. If you go on the webcam at the moment, you'll just see a dirty great hole with a load of mud. But this is the artist's impression. At the top there, you see it's 3.3 kilometers long, going from Daisy on the outskirts of Hamburg into Schelsnick-Holstein at Schönefeld. It's a very long tube. Basically, it's a long accelerator, about 2 kilometers. And then it splits up into beam lines. These are meant to be the undulators, the magnets. You see at the bottom left there where the beams split, and then the final analysis station at the end. Well, that's what it is. It's being built at the moment. 12 countries are involved, and it's all very exciting, including Russia and China. That's going to be interesting to see how data is handled there. Why is so much excitement? Well, it's a billion times brighter than current X-ray sources, such as synchrotrons. But more importantly, look along the bottom there, it's operating in near the femtosecond time resolution. And for me as a material scientist, to be able to see an atom move in real time at atomic resolution is really exciting. And as soon as I saw this picture in 2001, I told our minister we had to be involved. As soon as I left Rutherford, of course, we pulled out, but that's another story. hopefully, we'll come back in. It really is probably the most one of the most exciting projects going. And why is it? Well, it's about looking at things in time and space at extremes. And this happens to be an early diffraction pattern from the prototype. And so you've got your X-rays coming in, hitting the sample. You can do things to the sample. You can use optical lasers to excite the state. You can do all sorts of experiments. And in the meantime, you get your diffraction pattern. And the other thing is you actually kill your molecule as well because you've hit it with so much energy. And the question initially was, could you get the diffraction image out before the sample disintegrated? I'll leave that one. This is the picture here. You hit it, and you get the data, and the thing shatters. And you can do this in times of a few hundreds of a femtosecond each sample coming out. So you can imagine the amount of data that's going to come out. When I told my wife about this some years ago, she said it's like being shot by your friend and smiling at them before you realize you're dead. You're getting the information out as you kill the sample. And this is extremely important in looking at proteins because you don't now have to crystallize the protein. So you can look at membrane proteins and those 70% of proteins that you can't crystallize at the moment, you'll be able to see them here. And not only that, if you're clever, you can actually see them interacting with various drugs at an atomic level. Well, if you're not excited by that, I don't know. Well, you're probably all computer people. But anyway, this is one of the detectors, one of the five that's being built at the moment. This is a schematic, and you can see the pulses of X-rays as they come down. But the thing in red there, 10 gigabytes per second for one of these. and there are five of them, and they're meant to be seven in the steady state. And you can see the data generation rates. And this was the estimation of the storage space that DESE needed over the next few years, going up to 200 petabytes a year. Well, that pales into insignificance compared with the genomic data coming from Elixir. But you can start to see the challenge there of what they're expecting. Now, the problem here is that unlike CERN, who think they know what they're looking for, where they take out most of the data before it comes out, here you don't know what you're looking for. You may be in 1 hour doing a biologic experiment, the next hour you're doing experiments on environmental sciences, and the one after that on engineering. You don't have the algorithms and the background models to take out the spurious data. And so there's a really big challenge there to decide how to store it and how to handle it. And I don't think we're there yet. On top of all that, of course, we've got the supercomputer picture in Europe to inform these experiments. And you know about PRACE and how that's going. And two, I'm sure Carlos will talk about the Géant. We're linking all these things together, and we've got to make sure that we're world-leading as we see countries like India and even Southern Africa putting in e-infrastructures which are competitive with ours. Well, we've been into grids for a little while with EG, and now we're into EGI. And again, I think we need to think about how we interface these grids with the clouds and the infrastructures that we've got. EGI, again, I was responsible for the committee in UK putting our subscription to that. That's now underway in Amsterdam as a fully functioning, I think it's fully functioning, isn't it? Yeah, it is, organization. It's going to be interesting to see how that develops. But they're all important to this environment of dispersed science, if you like, dispersed research. This is a Microsoft side showing that researchers not only get data from research infrastructure, but all over the place. It's going to come from just about everywhere. And again, it highlights how you're going to train people in this environment. When I was a research student, I mean, I just used to get up in the morning, walk around, do some experiments on the transmission microscope, analyze the diffraction patterns, and write the paper. It wasn't quite as simple as that, but that more or less was the tracking. If I had to deal with all this lot, I wonder how I would have got on. I was a research student in Cambridge for the head of department, whose first advice was try something interesting. I think you need to be a bit more proactive than that now if you're going to train researchers in this environment. So, and of course, I've managed to transpose this a little bit badly, but you know, the poor old researcher, e-scientist and e-researcher is absolutely swamped with stuff. And I think we do need to look at how we train people in this area, how to organize it. And I think probably we need to share best practice around Europe and how to do this. Of course, a lot of research still and a lot of academics ignore all of this. I think that's a great mistake. And of course, there's far more information than we can even conceive of below the surface. And what we're looking at is the research paper being really just the tip of the iceberg. Underneath it is all the data, all the simulations and other things you can do working in different disciplines. And it's going to be a very big challenge for the public publishers. I was chairing a meeting last week in the British Library on this. And I think publishers are only just becoming aware of what can be done. Of course, some of them are aware and trying to make money out of the blob underneath the ocean. And I think that's equally dangerous. I won't mention any names, but I think we know who we mean. That they are looking to hold the academics and researchers onto them to pay the subscriptions, not for the bit at the top, because that would be freely available, but for the bit at the bottom. And that's the bit we really own. So we need to be aware of what's moving forward there. So what are the big issues? Well, we already heard about the energy requirement for data storage. Who is going to protect it? Do we give it to the great Amazon in the sky or whoever? Data terrorism is very real. We all know that, and we have to protect these data sets. It's going to get worse and worse. Do we trust other countries? Do we let our information be freely available to every country, including Burma? Yeah. Will they let their data be freely available to us? I don't need to answer that one. And the big one for me is that there are very, very few people who have any experience whatsoever of large-scale project management in this area. I've been doing a lot of work with the European Investment Bank recently, and some of us were talking about meeting in Warsaw. They've got a load of structural funds for research infrastructure, but they haven't got anybody who knows how to run the show. It's not that it's not that they're poor people, it's just they've not had experience. And so we need to share this experience. And of course, politicians say, why are we giving all this away? We're paying for it. It's ours. Actually, what I've got to demonstrate to them, it's of limited value to us if we hold on to it. It's much more valuable if we share it with others. So some initial conclusions, and I'm going to come on to a little bit about what the high-level group and AIRAB are doing. We've got to grasp this thing about the project management side, and that's why I like what CSC does here, because it's a good example of how to do things properly. How do we now develop these knowledge infrastructures that are dynamic so they don't become very static like old-fashioned libraries? How do we globally organize this? How do we train people in a virtual research environment? And researchers do have to have confidence to know what lies below the surface and who's looking after things for them. And of course, more and more, the information from this sort of research is going to policy advice. And so we've got to be pretty confident that we don't have the issues that we had with the climate change emails that went astray. I think it's very exciting, but I am also worried it could all go horribly wrong. Well, last year, I've been chairing this European Research Area Board, and last year we produced our first year report, and we were asked to look at, not at processes, so we're not looking at how framework works or anything like that, but where do we want to be in terms of Europe in 20 years' time? And the thing that came to us that we needed to be in the mode of thinking about a new renaissance. In other words, we needed holistic thinking about what we were doing, not individual thing. And that's what Commissioner Janusz Potocnik said in the opening introduction. This is a holistic thinking. So it's the same sort of way that the early Renaissance, the first Renaissance, looked at things. And since then, really it's only in the last 100 years, we've gone into this single discipline mode, and we need to get back out of it again in order to solve some of the big issues in front of us. And e-science is the tool to do it, so I think it is very exciting. We took six themes, and I'll look at these very quickly if I may, because you're probably more interested in the data side of things. We had to work together. If we're the largest economy, and in the world at the moment, just marginally bigger than some of the others. But the others are growing fast. We don't need to tell you about India and China. US is waking up thinking it's behind now. So everybody's suddenly realizing that we've got to keep moving, we've got to work together. There are some massive challenges in front of us. If we move towards 9 billion people on this earth, we ain't got enough water or enough energy, and we're gonna have to do something. So we've got to look at these grand societal challenges, because that's where Europe can add value. You shouldn't be doing things that the member states can do. We should be doing things which Europe can do together. And there needs to be a link between science, policy, and society. So, you know, those scientists out there destroying the Earth image has got to go. And so we need to engage much more. I don't know what it's like in Finland, but I'm not sure I can count too many politicians in the UK who actually understand what we're talking about. When you think of what's going on in China, where the majority of the Politburo are engineers and scientists, it's a very, they know what's going on and they know how to invest. Open innovation, if we keep all the information to ourselves, we're not going to get anywhere. We have to share. We had a discussion about this last week in the British Library. I'm willing to share your information, but I'm not willing to share my information. We've got to find a way of saying people get rewarded for sharing information. And so things like citing data sets is going to become a big issue. Excellence, I think, I hope I can say this here, I've seen under the structural funds a lot of projects funded which don't even get up to the good level, let alone the excellence level. We've got to focus on that which is excellence rather than anything else. And at the same time in Europe, we've got a lot of people, and certainly in Eastern Europe, who are severely disadvantaged, and we don't take advantage of their intellect and their resources and other things. And so we need to make sure we use all the resources we have available. And so cohesion is extremely important. Well, we came up with a number of milestones. There were originally 30. I don't want to go through them all because we'd be here for hours and hours. And I need that cup of coffee, whatever happens in a few moments. Just looking at some of these things here, that mobility triples to 20% of doctoral students, for instance. And so we're looking at the whole area of Madame Curie, Erasmus, and all these sort of things. The more we can move people around Europe, the more they get used to working together, not to dumb down the cultural aspects, but to actually allow people to share the different ways we do things. In this one, there we say 30% of all researchers need to be involved at some stage in grand challenges. Again, how you do that, and how do you train people in the multidisciplinary activity as well. And right at the bottom there, though, you see very clearly that one of the things is that we really start to employ the tools of e-science properly. I can say this because I'm not with you in that sense, but I think we're really at a very low starting point still. Whilst we talk about it, it's taking a long time to really get underway, and we need to push it forward very aggressively. When I first started in this game, and I can blame Keith Jeffrey for getting me into this, 10 years ago, Keith? 9 years ago, something like that. I said to our research councils, you know, this was vital, and the lady in charge of the office said, yes, I know it's very interesting, John, but it's terribly boring. I was glad to see that over 100 turned up to this meeting in the British Library, and there's a very lively debate about what we're doing. So the issue's becoming more talked about, and now we need to embed it in what we do with the people we train. Shared responsibility, this is about policy and society, that I think the one at the bottom there is we develop a code of ethics that researchers sign up to, rather like the doctors sign up to, in terms of trust, in terms of responsibility. And you can look at all of these in your own course. In terms of open innovation, we're working very closely on an open innovation charter and directive with the Commission. That will be resisted by a lot of governments, but I think we need, from our perspective, although it's mainly between industry, for researchers it's also important that we can share our information much more freely across boundaries. And so you can look at that. Probably the biggest one in there is the risk capital at the bottom. We're working on a European venture fund at the moment to try and fund startups and high-risk projects, because at the moment it's very, very little indeed. And so we're discussing that with the European Investment Bank. Risk-taking. Oh dear. All the politicians say, yes, what a good idea, but don't risk the money, will you? Let's put more auditors in. It's an absolute disaster at the moment, isn't it? I can't tell you some stories, but some of them are horrific. I think everybody's woken up to the fact that the way the financial regulations are used in the Commission really do stop innovative research. There are lots of discussions at the moment on simplification. And how do you define high-risk research? Because if we could get a good definition from it, I think we would win. Certainly the politicians in the Parliament I talked to said, if you can actually... We know there's a lot of fraud going on in areas like agriculture, but so we have to apply these rules. But if you can find a way of defining research so it's outside of this game, then perhaps we can move forward. And so the governance system for European research funding... we're arguing it should be at arm's length research council type of agencies. Again, at the moment, as you probably know, the European Research Council is going through the death throes of trying to become one, but it's not that easy with the financial regulations that are there and legal regulations. And that also applies to the European Institute of Technology, which is suffering very badly at the moment from the legal constraints. Okay, cohesion. Well, I think the key one here is the number two there, that the structural funds are used properly for developing research infrastructures and research across Europe. I'd say I can tell you some horror stories of some of the countries I've worked with in Eastern Europe where money's been given to old friends because they're old friends of the government rather than because the projects are good. I won't say any more than that because they probably sue me, but I have said it to them publicly. Okay, so we then moved on to this year. Not only what is the vision, strategic vision, but how we're going to get there. And there were three fundamental drivers. One was globalization, but see too that e-science and virtualization is number two. I mean, it's great. From a standing start 10 years ago, we've really moved up there, and the politicians are beginning to realize, and then we've got the grand challenges. And we've got to get the research policy system to respond to these, and this is a big challenge for me at the moment. I won't go through these. For the we whittled the 30 milestones down to 27, and then we gave 77 recommendations. You can read them if you like, but we're really saying what you need to do, and if you do them, what the impact is going to be. If you want to spend a happy day trying not to fall asleep, then do have a look at those. But these are the ones we're really working on, and these are the ones we presented in May at the Seville conference. So just a week or two ago, we produced our second report, which was how do we realise these issues? How do we make them happen? And when the commissioner, Mrs. Gagan-Quinn, said, I can't deal with 77 recommendations, they're too many. Give me 10. Well, we gave her 11, but we said it was 10 plus 1. And here they are. First of all, and I'll go through them in a little bit of detail. In fact, I'll move on because I think the next slide... Getting a European-wide patent. I don't know how many patents you've got. I've got 17, but the whole European patent situation is an absolute nightmare. And it holds things up in terms of innovation. A fast track for pre-commercial procurement of research and development. This is about using state money to procure technologies which you don't know if they're going to work or not. It's very similar to the DARPA and ARPA systems in the States. If we use that effectively, we would double the amount of money going into research. We would go past the 3%. I know Finland is beyond the 3% of GDP immediately. And this is the hiccup at the moment, is that we don't use procurement in this way. And so we're pushing very, very hard. I'm glad to say, actually, in the UK, we're starting to do it, and we're going to see more money going into this. The shout goes up that we're ignoring state aid rules. Well, the fact that other countries do it means that we've got to get on with it. Also, we've got to concentrate research and innovation funding. We spread it too thinly at the moment. The next one's my idea, actually, is that in addition to a city of culture, we have a city of innovation each year, which develops these technologies, whether it's for efficient transport or making sure 50% of your population is e-literate. I don't know. We leave it to the countries and the cities involved. But whatever it is that the technologies developed have to be transferable. This is the EU directive that I talked about earlier. Then to implement the pre-commercial procurement, you may think this is a irrelevancy. I can tell you this would dramatically revolutionise research if we did this properly. Concentrate and streamline 8 framework programme. Again, look at that, 10% of the common agricultural policy should be put into research. Well, we're running out of food, guys. We've got to do something. And why, with all that money in CAP, don't we put some of it into research? And then there's the risk-taking, the venture fund, and risk-oriented funding becomes actually the way we do things. So some of these are repeats, but it's in terms of when they become implemented. I won't go through these. This is a little bit more. Underneath each of these recommendations, we say what should actually be done. Oops, wrong way. The other thing, too, is we recognise we're working in a world environment. And where do global decisions get taken? Well, we all heard of the fiasco at Copenhagen following on from Kobe. So we're proposing that Europe takes a lead on this and brings research ministers and finance ministers together to sort out some of these issues so that we work together rather than in competition, because the issues before us are too big. We call it a Davos for research. It may or may not be at Davos, but that's irrelevant. But we now start to work. How do you take a decision on the square kilometre array, for instance? How do you take a decision on ITER properly without the mess we've got into? And so on. So that's what this is for. This is our 11th commandment, if you like. And I think it's one we could really see motoring. Well, this is the last, this is the final death row of my talk. A few weeks ago with the DG Information Society, we've been working for the last year, 18 months, with David here, to produce a vision, really, for what can we do about scientific data as we move towards 2030. I think we all came to the conclusion right at the start, we had no idea. Things will move too fast, and whatever we say is probably going to be wrong. But above all, we need to be aware and awake that things are moving fast. And we called it riding the wave because we saw it in terms of a wave, a tsunami wave. You can either be drowned by it or you can sit on top of it on a board and ride it. And so that's why we've called it that. People have asked why we chose that title, but that's the reason. So what was the context? Well, it's one of the flagships of Europe 2020, the policy document of the European Commission and the European Union. But inside, as it were, there's all sorts of things going wrong. Lack of investment, lack of interoperability, lack of skills, and you can see them all. So the context is fine, but when you get down to the reality, it's looking a bit of a mess. So we've got to sort things out. We're in this global world, and actually, as I've already shown, if we get it right, we can help contribute to solving the grand challenges before us. You don't need this slide, really, but these are the what's happening and predictions and what's happening to data and what's really happening from both the European Space Agency and elsewhere. And we all know it's going up at a fantastic rate, and every discipline you look at gives similar graphs. So I think there's no doubt about it. We all know that there's a real challenge in front of us. What do we do about it? And the question then is, what do we hang on to? What do we hang on to as individuals? What do we hang on in communities that is of cyclical nature? And what are things that we absolutely have to hang on to, come what may, so that we can make predictions about the future? And who's going to be responsible down the side? And you can see down the side there, we go from national to regional to private. It's based on some American work. What's the vision? Well, it's easy to write the words, isn't it? Vision is a science, e-infrastructure that supports seamless access, use, reuse, and trust of data. Ah, yes. Didn't take too long to write those words, but the reality is very different. How do we do it? And so I won't go through all of this in detail, but we have a number of headlines, and then we have a number of actions underneath. So we say that everybody's got to be aware of it. That's the key thing to start with, trying to make politicians aware, funders aware, and the community aware. And so underneath that, we then have a number of recommendations, such as publishing member state policies, the legal issues are worked out, and so on. And I won't go through it now, but I commend it to you. Each one of these will be the same. And again, interoperability between disciplines and access. What do we mean by access to the data? Is it in the raw data form, or is it a form that can be easily accessed? How can they understand it, and how can they evaluate it? And again, there are a number of recommendations under that. And of course, we also say, if you get this right, this will be the result. Data benefiting from opening it to broad access, that's the open access, so that people prefer to deposit and share their data with confidence in reliable repositories. Again, it goes back to trust, a whole load of things underneath that as well. Public funding rises because we need to actually get an investment into this. And that's justified because politicians can see the impact this has on policy development. And again, more on that. Vision 5, there is industry out there, excuse me, and a lot of companies involved, and we're seeing more and more. And we had meetings with Microsoft and Nature. We had a member of Oracle on the panel, and we don't ignore that part, but we need to see how that it works efficiently so that we have trust in both aspects, but using their intellectual and financial power to take things forward. Six, this is public science, cyber science, citizen science, whatever you like to call it. There was a meeting a few weeks ago in London at King's College on this, citizen cyber science. Very exciting projects about how anybody can take part now in the scientific work. I'm especially interested with my current job in what's going on in deepest Africa. And you can imagine somebody coming out of their village and seeing some artifact, whether it's a flower or a bug or something, typing it into their telephone, and it goes over to CERN. It becomes part of the LifeWatch project. I think it's going to be quite exciting how we involve the general public in this, and it could be our savior that, you know, with one of these things, they can all take part in some of the science. How do we train people to do that? How do we know that the bug they're seeing is really the bug that they think they're seeing, and so on? So we had a discussion on that. We've got to get policy makers involved. I have much more success in the European Parliament than I do in my own parliament about briefing politicians about the impact of what's going on, so that they base their decisions really on evidence, real evidence, not on phony evidence, and therefore the trust in government increases. And again, we've got to do this thing, all got to do it internationally, and surprise, surprise, I suspect, oh yes, we create a scientific Davos. It's amazing, the two meetings I chair came up with the same conclusion. I can't think how that happened, but it really is important we have a meeting where standards and interoperability issues are discussed. Okay, so how do we bring all this lot together? Well, we all know that data is all out there. It's all over the place, and we've got to get it in to something we can use and trust So for everything from patents, preprints, grey literature, and all the rest of it we all know about, how we can get it in. And yet at the same time, we realize that the bottom level there is the individual researcher in their individual discipline. They may be, as I was when I was doing research, I was an expert on electron diffraction of stainless steel. Well, somebody had to be in this world, and it was me. But I didn't look at this bigger picture at that time, and so we've got to see how they move into the more general area of their own discipline, mind of thinking, and then into the very much bigger, very much bigger sort of cloud that we're working in, where data is coming from all over the place, and researchers from different disciplines are working together. If you look at our report, you'll see some scenarios in there too, where we try to think of what it might look like for the researchers in 2030. My one was shortened to about a quarter of what it was, so if you want the full version, I can let you have it. It was much better than the one in here, wasn't it, David? But just thinking outside the box about how research will be done in this environment, how we're going to support things. What does the Commission support? What do member states support? And what are the services we need, both for the community and the data services, which are nationally or European-wide? Do we need a European data store? Which will be something like the European grid infrastructure in its form. I think there is a lot to be looked at if we take those forward. So you have things like personal identifiers, discovery and navigation tools, workflow generation, so on in there. And of course, we've got to make all this lots to work together. So data curation, I mean, I'm very pleased that in the UK, at least, we have a data curation centre, which my committee funds at the moment at Edinburgh and Bath and a little bit at RAL. But we need to widen this, that we not only do the research necessary, but we also turn it into a service that helps others rather than all reinventing the wheel. We've got to find a way of trusting the whole system. And I know most countries in Europe trust the networks now, their academic networks, but trusting the data stores is another matter. And so we get this perpetual cycle. It's like a perpetual motion machine, effectively, of moving around that which is persistent storage, with data discovery, with how you actually do the research, and back again. And so that's that. So this was our initial wish list that we put out, that user community data centers are open, and you can store in them, bitstream preservation, data authenticity is guaranteed for a certain number of years, format and content migration, etc., at the command of the communities, persistent identification. Obviously, you need to know who's coming in and going out, allowing data centers to register a huge amount of markers to track, metadata support and discovery, maintaining proper access rights as the basis of trust, so if somebody abuses it, they are cut off, a variety of access and curation services to help different disciplines, allow services that help large groups of researchers to operate on the stored data together, high reliability, so you know that the data hasn't been changed or polluted in some way, regular quality assessment to make sure that everybody's obeying the standards that are there, distributed and collaborative authorization and accounting, and a high degree of interoperability at format and semantic level. So those are the wish lists that have gone forward, and maybe we'll hear some more about that later. I don't know what this is meant to do. Hang on, we'll get there soon. Okay, so this gets to the end. We presented this report to the Commissioner, Nellie Crowes, a few weeks ago, and really we are inviting everybody to take note of the report and use it as a background reference when discussing priorities, especially under Framework 8. And one thing that Nellie Crowe said when we were there, she was going to integrate what we've been saying with another group that's been looking at publications and put out a policy document linking data and publications together sometime next year. So we look forward to seeing that. And I think that's about it. Okay? We've got some grand challenges in front of us, some really great opportunities. I think when we look back at this time, out of this mess that we've been in, we'll start to see some growth occurring, and I hope this meeting and others and this initiative will take them forward. So thanks very much. Did you take a few questions? Yeah, okay. What's the time? hierarchy.
Good state. So John will take a few questions.
Don't forget, I'm not a computer scientist.
not a computer scientist question. Actually, related to your presentation, you know, as you know, we have a lot of interesting and successful research.
Hang on, Kimo. Well, I can hear you, but I think the room people behind you can't very easily.
Maybe you can repeat the question.
That means I've got to listen to it. I'm a politician. I answer my own question, not what Kimo's going to say.
Now it works, right?
Yeah, okay, give it.
So the question is actually that now you presented a lot of interesting and successful vertical research infrastructure work. And then we know we have these e-infrastructures, which are more or less in the horizontal layer. The kind of a feeling that even though both of these are going quite okay and there is a lot of good work done, there's not enough activities to link these two worlds. So how do you think that we could manage to make a better, you know, reinvention of wheel between these two different kind of worlds?
Yeah, and Kimo, you're absolutely right, actually, because a lot of the research infrastructure didn't even have a data management plan to start with, let alone doing anything about it. And I think David will know, and Keith will know, that even the Large Hadron Collider seemed to ignore data to start with, and suddenly some of us had to find funds to support it. I was at the I was in Washington last week, was it the week before? I forget now. At the NSF, and we were having a discussion about just this, and they're now insisting all projects have a data management plan in. The question is, how can you make sure that plan is done? And the NIH now, I understand, are refusing to make the final payment on a project if it's not integrated in some way. So I think there's a certain amount of threats are needed to make this happen. We did an analysis at Imperial College on how people store their data. And I can't remember the exact figures, but it was less than 5% do it in any meaningful way. So this is why I keep coming back to this training of researchers. I think we've got to embed it as, this is what you do. So one of the things we've talked about, and we're starting to see, there are a number of modules being developed for researchers to train them. We've got to force it onto projects so that researchers know what's going on. And I mean, I've said to the commission, certainly to Hervé Perrault, that they shouldn't be funding any projects on research infrastructure unless this is actually stated right at the beginning. So I think we've probably meandered into this area, but we've got to take some very positive steps. I do think it's up to your community to provide the tools, though, to help train people. Does that help? I mean, we really got to push for this. There's somebody up here.
Thank you. I would like to have asked about the grand challenges. We have been working very much with these, but what will be the definition? What will be the recognized grand challenges in the framework program 8, so that you had some of them named in your slides, but there has been a lot of discussion about what are really the grand challenges and how they will be defined by the European Commission.
Yes, well, luckily I don't have to define them, but what I do say is, my definition is, what are those things in front of us which it makes more sense for Europe to work together on rather than individual member states. So that's how I come at it. A lot of it will still be individuals working on these projects. I mean, I sometimes say to politicians, what keeps you awake at night? Of course, it's not the same thing that keeps me awake at night. But if we're moving to 9 million people and there's not enough water around for them to drink, that sure is a grand challenge. We're looking at the pandemics that sweep across the world now. That sure is a grand challenge, and so on. I'm almost not too worried about how you define them. It's really, as far as I'm concerned, and I'll say this bluntly, I think we've got muddled up, especially in some of the funding mechanisms, about what's best done at member state level and what's best done at European level and what's best done globally. And that's why I argue for this sort of Davos type thing, that we actually sort some of these things out. Because your energy requirements will be very different from those of Saudi Arabia, for instance. So we need to have an environment when those can be discussed. Is it right to define them too closely? I'm not sure it is, really. But do you have ideas?
No, the question is that how they will be working with the framework program, what kind of calls, how it will be structured in the framework program.
Well, as I said, we weren't asked to look at the processes under the framework program. I mean, frankly, I'd kick the framework program out myself and start the game. That probably won't happen. I didn't make the heretical comment that why don't we give all the framework funding back to the member states on the condition they work with at least two other countries with that money and see what happened. I hate to say that the Commission weren't too pleased at that recommendation. But it's something that could be considered because joint programme isn't really working at the moment, and that could be a way of doing it much more effectively. But I have a lot of friends in Brussels. I don't want to offend them too much. But we need to think outside the box whether the framework programme is effective. I mean, I don't know about you. I was on a couple of evaluation panels this year, and there were some dreadful projects that everybody gave a 4 to, which said they were very good. I said, but these are dreadful projects. Yes, yes, but we can't give them a 3 because it's insulting and we'd have to justify it. I think, well, what on earth are we doing? This is crazy. And people are putting a vast amount of effort into these things, and it's just a waste of time. Why not give it to a few people and take a high risk? Yeah. That's what we used to do. I can say all these things now because I don't get any money from the project. Anybody else? No, I think we're there. Can I have my coffee?